And thank you, everyone. Thank you for having me here today to talk a little bit. I'm trying, as usual, I think I probably have more slides than the allotted time, so I'm going to try and go through these pretty quickly. We're going to talk about some forensic applications for PFAS. So I think one of the most important things is when we look at and consider that, you know, forensics is really in many cases just a reapplication or a redefinition of how you use current tools that you already have. So current tools that we already use in the analysis and identification of PFAS. And some of those are chemical fingerprinting, isomer comparison, and then some applications of the total oxidizable precursor assay. And we also want to talk about a couple of additional, and Leonard brought this up already with the total organic fluorine analysis. And that's somewhat of a misnomer because, as he pointed out, depending on how you handle and prepare that sample, you don't always have exclusively the organic fluorine or the inorganic fluorine, but you do a reasonably good job to separate those. But anyway, looking at TOF, total organic fluorine analysis, or non-target analysis using, and here's to use that acronym again, a qTOF, so a quadrupole time of flight mass spec. So I always like graphic that I borrowed from ITRC is to, you know, just to reiterate that when we're looking at PFAS and so much of our discussion is around the anionic forms of PFAS, there's really a whole other world of, by definition, PFAS. And that is if we look and characterize them by polymeric forms versus the non-polymeric forms. And then even within the non-polymeric forms, we've got the anionic forms that the surfactants that we're typically looking at. There are cationic forms, zwitter ionic, neutrals like fluorotelum or alcohol. So we've got a broad variety of things that when you're doing and want to apply some kind of forensic analysis can make a difference to your end determination if you can broaden the scope of compounds and chemistries that you're looking at. So typically for fingerprinting, we are using this, our PFAS determination by isotope dilution, because we can apply it across a wide range of matrices and for a large list of compounds. We recently announced that we were up to 70 target compounds that we could do by this isotope dilution analysis. And then to show an example of that, in some cases it's just really a replot or a different graphical representation of your targeted compound analysis. So this article out of Chemisphere from 2012, where did some characterization of three different types of AFFF. And so where we've got some that are a newer generation, so they're predominantly a 6,2 FTS and along with a fluorotelum or alcohol, the 6,2-8,2 FTOH, one that is actually much more predominantly the 6,2 FTS, and then sort of a legacy PFAS, which is your sulfonic acid, your PFOS, your heptane sulfonic acid, hexane sulfonic acid treated. So looking at it graphically like this, that becomes pretty obvious that we've got three different sources or three different types of materials that contributed PFAS. The other would be to look at isomer comparison, and that is in very loose terms comparing the linear versus the branched chain isomer. And the thing we always like to caution is that when we refer to branched chain isomer, because we've got a single name calling it branched chain isomers, we got to remember that is a plural, isomers, and that branched chain represents many different isomers, many different compounds that are PFOS versus the one compound, the linear PFOS. And we can do just a qualitative comparison where chromatographically we look to see what a linear standard of PFOS looks like, then what we would call a typical or a standard, because this is a standard reference material of the branched linear mix. So you can look at those ratios. You see in this case with PFOS, we actually have three peaks, the larger peak being the linear, the medium peak, the mama peak, if you will, being the single substituted branched isomers, and then that little That little baby peak there, that's right above the number five, or actually the dye substituted branched isomers. And then to compare that with some environmental samples where we've got retention time matches for the branched and linear isomers, but we can see that their respective ratios are substantially different from the standard and what we might expect. So we'd call this a high bias, or we can, by separately integrating each of those peaks, we can then categorize and have show relative amounts, basically a ratio of the intensities of the branched versus the linear, and tabulate that as well as and compare to one that has a low bias. So, and then compare those differences between between different sources, and if that potentially makes a difference to source identification. So it's another piece of the puzzle. It's not necessarily going to take you absolutely from A to B and give you an absolute conclusion, but it gives you supporting evidence that could potentially lead you to a conclusion. Total oxidizable precursor assay. So just to, and not to be down on this too far, but you know, the general concept is we've got, as was mentioned before, you've got precursors that can be oxidized, can be in the laboratory forcibly oxidized to terminal end products, or basically perfluorocarboxylic acids. In some cases, we see some sulfonic acids, but primarily perfluorocarboxylic acids. And those we can detect readily and quantify readily. So we analyze a portion of the sample as is. That basically gives us our baseline or background. We take a second portion of the sample and we analyze it, oxidize it. And then after oxidation, you know, with persulfate and raising the pH and heating it for up to 8 hours, then force that oxidation, neutralize it, and then analyze that for your list of PFAS. And in that, you get some, what we've seen is characteristic patterns, which if you've got characteristic patterns based on the compounds, the precursor compounds that you've oxidized, you can start to stipulate or postulate on what some of those beginning compounds, materials were that were analyzed. So in this case, I'm showing the, I jumped ahead too fast there. In this case, we're showing the, results for the when we were trying to compare our analytical technique to the reference, which was Erica Houtz's article in ES&T, and so showed relatively comparable results. And then as a because of that, we felt that we were doing the procedure reproducibly, at least relative to what she was doing. But you see, we've got this characteristic pattern for 6,2-FTS, the butanoic acid, the pentanoic acid, and the hexanoic acid. And you get that same kind of characteristic pattern for the different, all of the different PFAS compounds that you are known precursors that you are able to get standards of and compare. So then we can make some, you know, potentially make some stipulations and postulations about source materials. So if you look at top assay of different potential contributing sources and then look at the top assay versus the impacted site or impacted area, you potentially have patterns of carboxylic acids that may be characteristic of that source. Again, it's not an all or nothing, but it's some contributing data, contributing evidence. And this is typically the kinds of results that you get out of that top assay result, where pre-ox, not much for the short chain carboxylic acids, but then post-ox, because we had some precursor compounds there, we saw a decent jump in short chain carboxylic acids, increase in the hexanoic acid and others. So of the newer techniques, and as I mentioned before, Leonard basically talked about and did the comparison with the combustion ion chromatography. And that is what we're going to talk about a little bit about here. And that is with the total organic fluorine analysis using combustion ion chromatography, it's sort of a marriage between TOX, which, you know, has been in use for years in characterizing hazardous waste. now is getting into a greater level of detail, greater level of detail in the analysis, because we're then collecting that effluent and bubbling it into a, as we mentioned before, a trapping solution or a buffered solution that we can then take and inject onto a ion chromatograph and selectively chromatograph and look for fluoride anion and quantify that. And as we've got to show here graphically, we've got some different ways that we can approach that. And in the previous talk was comparison between AOF and EOF. And then actually even with soils, you know, you can look at the comparison between TF and EOF. And actually we can envision probably some additional work in that to try and help and further delineate how much of it is organic versus how much is inorganic fluorine. And just the graphic of what the instrumentation, I think we saw a little bit of that before. And again, definitions around EOF and AOF. The ASTM has a procedure, has a method that's been proposed. I think it's still in draft form for AOF, which is adsorbable for being passed through a carbon plug and then combusted and analyzed. And just a brief summary for the AOF, 100 mils of sample through a charcoal bed, do a rinse with some nitrate to remove the inorganic fluorine. So you've got a reasonably good chance, even in high inorganic fluoride content samples, to rinse that away. And then what remains is your organofluorine. Now, the possible limitation here, if we think about carbon and some of the, even in the earlier talks where we mentioned a carbon bed for cleaning PFAS or removing PFAS from influence. Well, you know, the problem there is that carbon is really retentive for certain PFAS and less retentive for other, like short chain acids. So then we may have potentially a bias there.
Chuck, 3 minutes left.
Thank you. And then the extractable organofluorine. And here we use, and I mentioned using a weak anion exchange. I think it was a different chemistry. But again, what EOF is, and in this case AOF, becomes a function of that sample preparation. So the definition of that prior to the fluoride determination is critical. And then just here's some data that we generated off of our system, the unit we're running in-house, where we just did some relatively simple spikes with known concentrations of PFAS. And also then this one down in red down at the bottom is where we took a mix of PFAS and using the QC material that's used for a TOC analysis, total organic carbon analysis, added some organic carbon. And we see that as we increase the organic carbon content, it did have an impact on our recovery from that carbon plug. Then the last thing I'm gonna try and blow through here quickly is non-target analysis. And that's using qTOF, where we've got the advantage to be able to do targeted compound analysis. And then from that, do essentially library searches with what I'll call limited chemical libraries, fluorochemical libraries, to try and identify PFAS. And there we run into a problem that are a challenge that our PFAS libraries are not as large, but we can use this accurate mass that we get from the qTOF analysis to help us uniquely identify these. So even if those search algorithms against those libraries are not able to give a good match, a good positive match for PFAS, identifying a PFAS compound, we are able to, based on retention time, the empirical formula generated, and the accurate mass that's generated within groups of samples, use that to potentially identify markers within samples to then again go and identify source content. And
1 minute.
Just a brief example of where, you know, through an actual sample analyzed, the tentative identification that came up with the compound listed. And I'm going to stop there. Otherwise, we'll run long.